To have folks make a commitment to the church. So that's pretty exciting. I think it's a pretty good sermon coming up. You guys don't know yet, but I think it's pretty good. So stick around for that. We've got some really good scripture, and these guys have been practicing, and they sound fantastic today. So we're going to be singing some good music today. Hey.
Okay.
But on pumps.
I think they sound fantastic. You tell them later, right?
Oh, they will.
And they will. Typically, like every other church, you will. So we are glad to have you here. A couple of announcements before we get going, though, on a more serious note. The first thing is, though, before I forget, Tuesday evening at 6 o'clock, if you are one of those folks for whom computer is a four-letter word, we are having our first computer kind of learning class. Nick's going to give that for us at 6 o'clock on Tuesday night and every fourth Tuesday of the month for as long as we need it. And so if you would really love to use email but can't figure that out, if you would like to be able to be a little easier and use your tablets, maybe your phone, things like that, make sure you bring, if you can, your device, if it's handheld, come on Tuesday night and we're going to try to help. Teach some folks how to use some technology.
Is this going to turn into a monthly tech support session?
Maybe.
Okay.
Maybe. We'll see how long it goes. But that's the first thing. So that's this week on Tuesday. The second thing is, for those of you who are members already, we are moving into an important time in the discernment process that we've been talking about for the last 6 weeks or so. And this is the time for us to take kind of a straw poll to see kind of where the church, where the congregation is sitting on the idea of disaffiliation or not. And so this morning, I believe, went out in the mail, or yesterday, last night, went out in the mail, what's going to be lovingly called a straw poll. And it's out in the mail and inside the letter, so keep your eyes open, but inside the envelope is going to be kind of a ballot, per se, just check off where you're kind of thinking that you would vote if we have a vote. And then underneath that, there are going to be some sections where if there's things that you really want to know more about, you can fill that out for us and so that we know what issues to address in the next couple of weeks. If a vote's coming, it'll be in the next couple of weeks. So we're going to find that out too. Now, what you'll notice on this mailer is there is nowhere to put your name. Please don't put your name anywhere on it. It is supposed to be an anonymous thing. And so when you get it in the mail, keep your eyes open again. It needs to be returned to the church this week. At some point, we're hoping that you will have, well, we need to have it postmarked by Friday. Okay, so we have it postmarked by Friday before we mail it in. There is a stamped self-addressed envelope inside, so you can just fill it out, put it right back in, take it to the mailman, or give it to the mailman. We will also have a box, if you forget, we'll also have a box in the office on next Sunday that you can just drop in. And so those are the two ways that you can bring that back. But it's important that you fill that out, just letting us know kind of how you're leaning in various ways. That's important, and that's this week, so it's kind of an exciting thing for that. Is that all I got? I think that's all I got. Anybody else? Anything important that I left out? No? Okay, well, that being the case, let's stand. We will begin our worship today with our affirmation of faith. This morning, this affirmation of faith is prayer of St. Francis, and so let's pray together. Lord, make me an instrument of your peace. Where there is hatred, let me sow love. Where there is injury, pardon. Where there is doubt, faith. Where there is despair, hope. Where there is darkness, light. And where there is sadness, joy. O divine Master, grant that I may not so much seek to be consoled as to console, to understand as to understand, to be loved as to love. For it is in giving that we receive, it is in pardoning that we are pardoned, and it is in dying that we are born to eternal life. Amen. Let's join together as we sing our opening praise song, Open the Eyes of My Heart. Take it away.
One.
seated, and I want to invite the kids up, the young disciples up today. I woke up with a sore back, so I'm going to make all kinds of noise getting down here and getting back up again. Phew! How's it going today? Good? You good? Good. So I have a question for you. We usually start with a question, don't we? How do you get your thinking? What time do you usually eat dinner? 6, 9, sometimes that's very European, 8, 9 o'clock. But 6 o'clock, 5 o'clock, whatever time it is, 9 o'clock. If you went, who makes dinner? Mom, who makes dinner? Okay, you can never assume.
Dad,
okay, sometimes it's dad, sometimes mom. All right, it's never me. It's never me. Mom and dad, okay, I like that. It doesn't happen in our house. Probably not too. But anyway, that's a whole other thing. So let's say mom is making dinner today, just for sake of argument. Dinner's at 6, okay? This is our story that we're on. Dinner's at 6, mom's making dinner. Now, if you went to mom at, let's say, 10 minutes to 6, said, Mom, I'm getting a snack, what would she say?
No.
No, but you're hungry.
Because it's almost dinner time.
It's almost dinner time, right? And if you have a snack at 10 minutes to 6 and dinner's at 6, what happens?
You're not hungry.
Yeah. You ruin your dinner. You're not hungry for dinner. Okay. If you go to mom and you say, I'm just going to have ice cream for dinner. I appreciate your effort. All the dinner that you make looks really good. But today, ice cream for dinner.
No.
Would that go over?
No.
Wouldn't go over?
No.
When you're grown up?
No.
You can do that. That's why I'm a little heavy on it. You wouldn't do that? That's smart of you, because actually you should be eating vegetables and all that stuff. But she wouldn't allow you to do that either, would she? If you said, Mom, I'm just going to have ice cream, she would say,
No,
I don't think so. Why? Because it's not good for you. It's not good for you. Whatever it is. Cake, chocolate cake. Although Bill Cosby has a great skit of chocolate cake and how it's just wheat and eggs and milk, and so it's good for you. But that's a whole other thing. So sometimes we want things that we don't get to have. We don't get to have ice cream for dinner because it's bad for us. We don't get to eat something at 10 minutes to 6 because if mom's right, we only have to wait 10 more minutes, right? We only have to wait just a little while and then we can have something to eat. Sometimes when we pray, we're going to talk about prayer today. Sometimes when we pray, God says, yes. Sometimes you ask your mom for something, she says, absolutely. You get home from school and you want to have, I don't know, I used to have pizza rolls. You have pizza rolls?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I used to have pizza rolls. Again, that's why I'm a little too heavy. But I used to come home from school and say, Mom, can I get some pizza rolls? She said, yeah, go ahead and have some pizza rolls. So sometimes we ask for things and we get a yes. Sometimes we ask for things like ice cream for dinner and we get a no. And sometimes we ask for a snack 10 minutes before dinner time and we get a not yet. I'll give you something to eat, but you gotta wait. We're going to talk about prayer that way. Sometimes we ask God for things. Sometimes he says yes. And sometimes he says no. But sometimes it's a not yet. And that's the hardest. Those are the hardest ones to take. Because we don't like waiting. Is that fair?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it is fair. So let's focus today on allowing God to act in our lives on God's time, not our own. Can we do that? It's hard to wait, but we got to try. Okay, let's pray. Father, we trust you. We believe. Help our disbelief. Help us to trust in you more every day. Hear our prayers. We know you hear them. And we know sometimes we don't get the answer we want. But Lord, we do know that you see things from a different perspective. And so you answer what's our best interest, not what we want the most. And even though it's hard, thank you for that. So watch over us. Keep us safe. and keep your will in our lives. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you so much for coming up. I appreciate it. And we'll, not going to make much noise again. All right, ladies and gentlemen, we're going to start in the scriptures today with a little bit of Psalm 103. We're going to be reading the first 8 verses. This is a prayer from David, from King David, and it is a thanksgiving for God's goodness. So hear these words from King David. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is in me, bless his holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and do not forget all his benefits. Who forgives all your iniquity, who heals all your diseases, who redeems your life from the pit, who crowns you with steadfast love and mercy, who satisfies you with good as long as you live, so that your youth is renewed like the eagles. The Lord works vindication and justice for all who are oppressed. He made known his ways to Moses, his acts to the people of Israel. The Lord is merciful and gracious, slow to anger, and abounding in steadfast love. Amen?
Yeah.
Amen. Let's pray. Father God, we do bless you today. All that is within us, we bless your name, we bless your claim on our lives. We lift up our voices and our hearts to praise you, to thank you for the blessings that you have rained down upon us. We thank you for the forgiveness that you've offered to us. We thank you for being a God of second chances because we need so many of them. Lord God, we recognize you as the great physician. You heal our diseases. You heal our brokenness. And so, Lord, we pray that for all who are suffering today, that you might reach down and touch them in some way. Touch us and make us whole. Touch us and heal the brokenness. Help us to see the brokenness in others and to look upon them not with scorn, but instead with compassion. Rather than pointing fingers, Lord, we ask that you empower us to lift our hands to help those who are in need instead of walking past and looking down. We ask your forgiveness for passing by those who are calling out. We ask your forgiveness for passing by those who are suffering from oppression, discrimination. But Lord God, we ask that you open our eyes. Open the eyes of my heart, we sang earlier. But Lord, we don't want to just see you, and that's a big ask. We also want to see your will. We want to see the world as you see it. We want to serve in a way that responds to your heart breaking. We want to be the Jesus that some people may only see in us. So send us forth later this morning, clothed in your righteousness, reflecting your love, offering to serve, offering to heal. We are your children. Let us live up to the name that we claim. I pray all this in the name of that name, Jesus. And I ask, Lord, that you hear us now as we lift the prayer that you taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen and amen. Let's sing our prayer response today. He touched me. Love this song.
Thank you.
Speaking of, I want to welcome everybody who's watching online, including my mother. She watches every week. I want to invite all of the folks who are going to join the church today to come forward, or forward from behind me, actually. Ask you one up. Now, there you go. Come on, where everybody can see you. I'll turn around. You stay over here. I'll make sure everybody can see you. Glowing, happy faces. So we had our new member class last Sunday after worship was over. We had a bunch of folks that came. We had some folks that were looking to join, and we had some folks who were looking for a refresher on kind of United Methodism 101, and I was thrilled to see so many folks that came for that. But I was more thrilled to see some folks come who want to join the church, and so we welcome you. The joining of the church, just so you know, in Methodism is a three-part thing. First, we will ask them to renew their baptismal vows. Second is we'll ask them to make some vows to the church. And then you have a part. And so you have a vow to make as well to support them in their Christian walk. So get ready. There is a response that will be on the screen as well. But first, you all, I'm going to ask you again to renew your baptismal vows. Find the right page. So on behalf of the whole church, I ask you, do you renounce the spiritual forces of wickedness, reject the evil powers of this world, and repent of your sin? If so, say, I do.
I do.
Do you accept the freedom and power God gives you to resist evil, injustice, and oppression in whatever forms they present themselves?
I do.
Do you confess Jesus Christ as your Savior, put your whole trust in His grace, and promise to serve Him as your Lord in union with the church which Christ has opened to people of all ages, nations, and races?
I do.
And according to the grace given to you, will you remain faithful members of Christ's holy church and serve as Christ's representatives in the world? If so, say, I will.
I will.
As members of Christ's universal church, will you be loyal to the United Methodist Church and do all in your power to strengthen its ministries?
I will.
And as members of this congregation, will you faithfully participate in its ministries by your prayers, your presence, your gifts, your service, and your witness?
I will.
Members of the household of God, I commend these persons to your love and care. Do all in your power to increase their faith, confirm their hope, and perfect them in love. And your response. We give thanks for all that God has already given you, and we welcome you in Christian love. As members together with you in the body of Christ and in this congregation of the United Methodist Church, we renew our covenant faithfully to participate in the ministries of the church by our prayers, our presence, our gifts, our service, and our witness, that in everything God may be glorified through Jesus Christ. Amen. Join me in welcoming them as members of our church. Just so you know, you guys can go and find your seats again, and I'll talk a minute while you're doing that. Just so you know, we also have another transfer of membership. My wife Jennifer transferred her membership from Cheyenne, Wyoming this week, and so she is joining us as well. But she is right now in Calgary, Canada, on her way to Ireland, taking my youngest daughter to Dublin, to Trinity College there. So she wasn't able to join us today, but she transferred her membership this week. Okay, so God bless this congregation.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. All right, let me get stuff squared away here. This morning we're going to be hearing from a passage from the Gospel of Luke. Is our sermon scripture today. This is the second, actually this passage is the second of three stories in Luke where Jesus heals someone on the Sabbath and gets a hard time from the Pharisees for it, because healing on the Sabbath was tricky. So in the story, I want you to focus on two primary subjects as you're listening. The first is the woman that you're going to hear. She's kind of the main character other than Jesus, of course. in the story. She's the one that you'll hear about. So focus on her and her situation. And then I also want you to focus on the controversy over healing on the Sabbath. So think of those two things as you listen to Luke 13, verses 10 to 17. Hear these words. Now Jesus was teaching in one of the synagogues on the Sabbath, and just then there appeared a woman with a spirit that had crippled her for 18 years. She was bent over and was quite unable to stand up straight. When Jesus saw her, he called her over and said, "Woman, you are set free from your ailment." When he laid his hands on her, immediately she stood up straight and began praising God. But the leader of the synagogue, indignant because Jesus had cured on the Sabbath, kept saying to the crowd, "There are 6 days on which work ought to be done. Come on those days and be cured, and not on the Sabbath day." But the Lord answered him and said, "You hypocrites! Does not each of you on the Sabbath untie his ox or his donkey from the manger and lead it away to give it water? And ought not this woman, a daughter of Abraham, whom Satan bound for 18 long years, be set free from this bondage on the Sabbath day?" When he said this, all his opponents were put to shame, and the entire crowd was rejoicing at all the wonderful things that he was doing. This is the word of God for the people of God today. Thanks be to God. When I was a kid, I used to play baseball every year. I was a catcher. I used to love baseball. It was one of my favorite pastimes until football really got its hook in me. But baseball, I grew up playing all the time. And my favorite players at that time, Johnny Bench. Anybody remember Johnny Bench? Johnny Bench, he was the poster I had hanging on the wall. Johnny Bench and Gary Carter in 1986 when he and his Mets won the World Series. So they were two catchers, you know. So I was a big baseball fan. So if you're a big baseball fan, which I think a lot of you are, because it seems like the Astros are more loved than the Texans. Is that true?
Yes.
That is true?
Yes.
Is that because they're winners?
Yes.
Yes, probably? Okay. I'm just curious. I'm not bashing on the Tech. Okay, a little bit I'm bashing on the Tech. But if you're baseball fans like I was a baseball fan, you probably have heard of the curse of the Bambino. You ever heard of that?
No.
Some of you, yes, the curse of the Bambino. Good. So just for those of you who don't, the curse of the Bambino was a superstition surrounding the Boston Red Sox, who, after having one of the most successful baseball teams early on, winning 5 of the first 15 World Series, they sold Babe Ruth to the New York Yankees. I know, we hate the Yankees too, right? But we don't hate them, because I shouldn't say that in church. We really dislike the Yankees. Is that fair to say? We love them and we wish for the best for them. We just hope they don't win. So, but after they sold Babe Ruth to the Yankees, it took 86 years for the Red Sox to win another World Series. And that was the curse of the Bambino. It took them from 1918 to 2004 to win it all once again. Now, 86 years is a long time. Don't forget, the record, though, is held by those lovely Chicago Cubs. 108 years it took them to win a World Series again. 108 years. Now, if you were a fan, imagine if you were a fan of one of these teams, or frankly any team that doesn't win a championship every once in a while, what do you say when the last game of the year ends? What's the words that come out of your mouth every year? There's always next year. Well, there's always next year, right? There's always that hope. Somehow we come back year after year, ready to root for our team once again. Because once again, something might be different. There's always hope. Now, I can imagine after 80 or 108 years, that gets old. That gets old. What did we learn about the woman in our scripture reading today? For 18 years, she's been afflicted with something that's kept her hunched over. Something that made it so where she couldn't stand up straight. She's probably in chronic pain. Anybody got that issue? She's been looking down at the ground for most of her life, unable to stand up, unable to meet people eye to eye, unable to fully interact with others. Movement wasn't easy, getting out of bed wasn't easy. Getting out of bed on Sabbath to go to Sabbath, go to synagogue, wasn't easy. But it seems to me that along with visiting every doctor she could find, or every doctor she could afford, she'd probably been praying, going to synagogue and praying for 18 years for a cure, an end to the suffering that never, the end that never came. But I can imagine, somehow imagine her thinking week after week, well, there's always next week. It's always next to you. And finally, the time came. Finally, one day, her persistence, her perseverance was rewarded, and she encountered God and was free. Keep in mind, the text does not say that she came to see Jesus. It doesn't say she came to church or synagogue that day because she heard that there was a miracle worker man that was there who was preaching. It doesn't say that she approached Jesus on her own even when she got there. All we're told is that she had been afflicted for 18 years and yet she still came to pray and to worship the same God who had heard all of her prayers and yet still allowed her suffering to continue week after week and year after year until he didn't. For the last couple weeks, we've heard the author of Hebrews talk about the great names of Scripture, right? The actions of faith that we're supposed to emulate. But actually, I think this woman and her story probably speaks more to our own experiences than Moses and Abraham ever will. Don't get me wrong. We obviously can and should learn from Abraham and Moses. We should learn that giving up of everything, following God, is admirable. It's something to truly work toward. But I think it's more likely that we can truly identify with the story of a person who simply prays over and over the same thing, praying for release, for freedom, for comfort, for no pain, and doesn't understand why it doesn't come week after week. Why doesn't God just give her what she's asking for year after year? Why doesn't God hear her prayer? When things like this happen to us, or worse, to someone we don't love, that's the question we ask, right? Why? Why is this happening? Why me? Why them? The one we love. Why doesn't God do something about it? There's an entire theological field of study called theodicy, which deals with that question, the why of pain and suffering in the world. And I don't think we're ever going to get an answer to that this side of heaven. But yet we keep asking. The question of why, especially when it's being asked in the midst of trials and suffering, often does more harm than it does good, particularly when it comes to our faith. I once had a conversation with a young lady who said she was losing her faith because God didn't provide what she was praying for. I tried to tell her, I said, God isn't like the genie in the Aladdin movie where you rub the lamp and make a wish. That's not God. Because God sees things from a wider and a deeper perspective, a longer perspective, eternal perspective. So the answer to our prayers isn't something that we necessarily know we're even asking for or looking for. But if we can build and hold on to our faith, having the persistence, the perseverance that we talked about last week, perseverance in our trust of God, then we can be assured that even if we don't see it, or even if we don't like it, our prayers truly never go unanswered. We can trust that God will answer our prayers in a way that aligns with His will for us. God's way, not ours. And we just have to trust that God knows best for us. Like when we ask for ice cream for dinner. It may not be the answer we want, though. Right? So we talked about it. Typically, God answers in one of three ways. When we ask for something in prayer, what are the three ways? Yes. No. Not yet. Yes, no, or not yet. The yeses we love. Right? The yeses we absolutely love. When I owned my own business during the recession of 2009, 2010, remember those years? It was terrible. And I can't tell you, well, I can tell you, it's 13 times. I went back and checked. 13 times on Friday morning, I had an invoice due Friday evening that I had none of it. I had no money to pay it. And so Jen and I got down on our knees in our store and we prayed, "Dear God, we don't know how it's going to come, but please provide for us. Give us this day our daily bread." And we closed the door at the end of the day. We had exactly the amount of money we needed. And doggone it, it was exactly. Jen, I love my wife. She speaks truths out into the world that I would be not embarrassed, but timid to say. She'd say, "God, why don't you give us just a little extra so I don't have to worry so much?" That's a daggone good question. But of course we know that the reason He doesn't give us a little bit more is because that makes us come back and trust Him even more, right? Because if we had extra, okay, God, I got this, thanks. But over and over again, we were answered with a yes. At exactly God's time. Now the no's we don't like, right? The no's we don't like, but at least we get a no. If we get a no, it's over and done with. We don't have to worry so much. A no is a no. So we got yeses, they're great. No's, not so great, but at least we know it's final. But daggone it, it's the not yes that really stink. Fair? Because we don't like waiting. And we don't know what we're waiting for change. But God looks down at the chessboard and He's moving things around for us so that He can give us exactly what we need. If we pray for a capital campaign and He brings somebody into place, He got to just drip a little blessing here, a little blessing there, and boom, capital campaign takes care of itself. But it may take a while. That's an easy church analogy. Right? Sometimes we have to wait. For 18 years, the hunched over woman held on to her faith. She hoped, she prayed for something to happen. How do we know that? Because she was in the synagogue after 18 years, praying to God, and she still was there. And all along, God was saying, "Not yet. Not yet. I need you to wait so that you can have an encounter with the risen Christ, with the Messiah. I need you to wait so that I can use your situation for my glory. Not yet." Now, her pastor, what did he say? You remember? "Why do you have to do this today? Couldn't you wait for tomorrow? Can't you just wait till tomorrow? It's Sabbath. You're not supposed to do it anywhere. I know you've been hunched over for 18 years. Can't you wait one more day?" That's what Good Lord, is that the pastor saying that? But yes, that was the pastor saying that. And Jesus said, "Wait, what are you talking about? This is exactly the day. This is exactly the day to share in the joy of this woman's healing. This is exactly the day to raise praise to God for what's being given to her. This is exactly the day." But hunched over was her normal. She could have waited one more day. It's how she knew life to be. But she also knew life to be so much more. And we look out at the world around us And it isn't difficult for us to see people who've been longing for relief, longing to be set free from their bondage, either some recurring sin or some affliction or discrimination of some kind. We see them and we know. We know that they know that their lives can also be so much more. And we're the same way. We're all afflicted in some way. We're all broken in some way. And for many of us, it's just our normal. But I'm here to tell you, your life can be so much more than just normal. Life after an encounter with Christ Jesus can be extraordinary, both for us and for those in our lives. The woman could have waited, but Jesus knew that her time for salvation was now. The pain, the time for her pain ending was now. All of the pieces had been put into place. All of the players had come together. There would be no more waiting. In fact, there should be no more waiting. It was on a Sabbath day, 26 years ago, that my encounter with Christ Jesus set me free. The same can happen to you. We come to this place each week in all of our faith and in the midst of our own afflictions to praise God. We come figuratively hunched over, looking downward, focused on the ground and the issues that surround us and affect us. And we come, and today we are reminded that the woman in our story had to wait a long time for her prayers to be answered. But now we also remember that one day, out of the blue, she was set free. When after hearing a voice called her, she turned her eyes from the ground and she looked full in the wonderful face of Jesus. Maybe today is that out of the blue day for you. I want you to take some time now together, just kind of sit silently, pray and meditate on the thing that's keeping you hunched over. The thing that's afflicting you, that's troubling you the most. Maybe it's an addiction, some kind of sin that you're addicted to. Maybe it's an anger issue. Maybe it's a need for control. Maybe it's a physical pain that you would love to be free of. Maybe it's something like all these, but in the lives of someone you love. I want you to take some time. Turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look full in his wonderful face, and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace. Thank you. Be perfect. Almighty God, we, your children, want to tell you today how much we love and trust you. Sometimes, in the midst of our faith, in the midst of our trust, sometimes we have moments, though. Moments where we wonder where you are, and if you ever actually hear us. But then we see a glimmer. We see a light shining in the darkness, guiding us from the struggles and the pain. Then we see that moment, that out of the blue moment, when it becomes clear that you've heard us all along. And so today, as we struggle with whatever it is that we're struggling with, Father, we pray, show us your glory. Show us your way. And help us to pray not for our will to be done, but your will in your time to be done. Because we know that sometimes the no, and sometimes the not yet, is better for us than a yes would ever be. We thank you and we praise you for watching out for us. We thank you and praise you for the gift that you give us of your love and of your Son, who is that ray of light in the darkness. Amen. Amen. Well, brothers and sisters, it is time as we again come together to share our lives together with one another, where we get to lift up prayers, joys, concerns that we have. If there's anything that you want us to know about that we can pray for you about, now would be a good time to do it. Again, I mentioned my wife and youngest daughter flying overseas, so prayers for travel mercies. Barbara was here, Barbara Brandeis was here at the 8 o'clock service. Her grandson passed away, some prayers for her family as they struggle with that loss. But anyone else? Yes?
Today is our 46th anniversary.
46th anniversary. And is that a joy or a reason? No, I'm just kidding.
Joy.
The answer might be different for all of you. Congratulations, that's a big deal. That's a big deal. Anybody else? Any more joys, concerns back here? Yeah.
I got my mom's letting me take Thanksgiving off, so me and Mom and my brother were going to Roswell to visit family for Thanksgiving.
Nice.
First time we've been with family for Thanksgiving for a long time. So.
That is truly a joy. Yeah. Congratulations on that. That's pretty cool. Love that. Anyone else? Behind me? In front of me?
Annalise slept a full night a couple nights ago.
Woo! That is a blessing. When babies sleep, it is truly a blessing. I remember. Thank God I don't have to do that anymore. Oh, did I say that out loud?
I'll give her tea.
Nope, that's okay. God love you. No, one night every once in a while I can do. I'm too old for that. anybody else? Yes.
I had gone astray for a while, and so I appreciate the opportunity to reaffirm my covenant with God and my commitment to the church, and be welcome with the other members as well.
Yeah, it's a joy for us as well.
Amen.
It's a joy for us as well, so thank you. Okay, let's pray. Father God, again, we thank you for being the giver of all good things. You bless us in so many ways. Bless us with family that we can celebrate with, travel to. We thank you for weddings that keep going. I love it. Thank you for your love. And we thank you for celebrating along with us. We thank you for kids learning to sleep. We thank you for the rain that we so desperately needed. It's raining on us this morning. We also come to you, Lord, humbly with our petitions. We come to you with our concerns of of loss in life. We come to you with our concerns of just suffering in some way. We thank you for letting go, helping us to let go, and to let you guide us and strengthen us. So, Lord, you've heard the prayers of our hearts. You know what they are. And so we now can turn everything over, trusting that you will answer in a way that is right for us and right for your kingdom. We also pray, Lord God, to thank you for the gifts that you've given to us. And this morning, as we take a moment to give back some of those gifts to your church, we ask that you open our hearts, guide us, let your Spirit guide us as we give freely and faithfully. And then bless this offering, multiply it, and guide the church in its usage of it so that we might make the biggest impact for your kingdom that we can. I pray all of this in the powerful and holy name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. If our ushers would come forward, let's go ahead and have our offering. We have special music during our offering today.
Clear, so I hold you.
Jesus, and help us to cooperate with the Holy Spirit that our lives may be made better and better for your kingdom. I pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Have a great, great week, and we'll see you next Sunday.